The MMA Discussion Podcast brought to you by sportsofanarchy.com. Visit our site for all your sporting news and needs. We're also brought to you by our sponsor, submissionfc.com. Use the promo code sportsofanarchy10 for 10% off your order at submissionfc.com for all of the best Brazilian jiu-jitsu gear. We're also brought to you by our sponsor, mmaprofit.com. Please play MMA Fantasy for free for the chance to win $100. Visit our site or the link below for more information. MMAD fans, thank you for joining us again for our 14th episode of the MMA Discussion Podcast. It's just a short panel here tonight, just me and your admin, Chris Shimina, the Katana. Chris, say what's up.
Thank you for having me back.
Yes, it's good to have you back. I believe I messed up your last name again, Shimina, right? Hello?
Yes.
Shimina, my bad, dude.
Yeah, it's my last name.
It's a mess. I'm a mess with these names. All right, anyway. This past weekend, Saturday, December 6th, I believe, it went down, UFC 181, one of the best cards I think I've seen all year. It was an awesome, awesome, awesome card. Chris, your thoughts?
Overall, I really loved it. Great title fights on both ends, some great finishes as well.
Definitely. There were a lot of finishes overall. I think there was only one in the Fox Sports 1 prelims, and then there was one decision in the main card. Everything else was finishes, and almost all of them were exciting. Basically, they were all exciting, essentially to me. Great card I from top to bottom, and we'll start, and we're going to review the UFC 181 card. We're also going to speak about the announcement that they had mid-pay-per-view about the signing of Phil Brooks, a.k.a. CM Punk, a.k.a. former WWE superstar. We'll start off with the first fight on the Fox Sports 1 main card, Raquel Pennington versus Ashley Evans-Smith. Now, I love this fight. That was a great fight. Raquel may have started off slow, but she kept the pressure and the pace high in her one rounder with Smith, and I was especially impressed with her originality almost. Most fighters don't generally look for chokes like that in a fight, but then again, not many people leave submissions like that open as well. But Rocky saw the opening, capitalized, and had one of the more impressive finishes in a fight, filled full in a card filled full of them. Definitely a big win for Rocky, and it shows that we really shouldn't take her lightly in any fight coming up, because I know that neither of us had her winning that fight.
Yeah.
As far as who's next for Raquel Pennington, I would personally like to see Sari Kaufman fight next. Raquel Pennington ate a huge elbow early on. She got busted open, but didn't let that slow her down. If anything, it fired her up, so she's down to get dirty and down and dirty, so... And it'll make for a great fight with the best of them. So who better to place her with than another girl who's just the same way? Sarah Kaufman, she's skilled everywhere. She loves a good scrap with just about anyone, and it makes for a terrific women's bantamweight fight. Who would you like to see Raquel Pennington face next? And first off, what did you think of her performance?
I did count her out. I was very impressed with her performance. Weathered the early storm. Didn't look good, really that great until the bulldog choke, which... I love a good fight with a bulldog choke, and it's always awesome to see that. Do I think she deserves this person that I would recommend for her to fight? Maybe not necessarily, but I still think it would be a really good fight, is Betche. I think her versus Betche would be a really good fight. And I think her versus Sarah Kaufman would be a really good fight, too. Just really good stand-up wars.
Yeah, definitely. I was impressed. Great fight overall. Definitely excited to see where she goes next. She definitely showed us that we took her very lightly in that fight. So, moving on. Corey Anderson versus Justin Jones. Now, in this fight, Corey Anderson really showed his range of wrestling skill in this fight. Jones also showed he's a powerful and dangerous striker. Anderson, however, also saw and probably felt that early on. And he adjusted accordingly in utilizing his wrestling to take over the fight and stay out of danger en route to the judge's decision. So a decent win. He looked impressive. Hopefully he can look a little more impressive next go around and start gaining some real momentum. But overall, smart and technical performance. As far as who's next for Corey Anderson, I would like to see him fight Alir Latifi. Latifi is coming off a loss, could definitely use a boost in his next fight, and defeating a tough winner could help with that. So plus, you know, fighting and possibly defeating a former headliner could do well for Anderson moving forward. What'd you think of Anderson's performance, and who would you like to see him fight next?
Really impressive, his well-roundedness, as well as a lot of takedowns scored for him in that fight. Justin Jones, I mean, not really knowing anything about him, and as if I could be wrong about this, but took this fight on short notice. He didn't necessarily look horrible either. As far as who to fight next, I'm just going to have to agree with you because I don't really know who to put him up against next, but you make a solid argument, so I'll just agree.
Yeah, sorry for the vibrating fans. That was my phone. I just got a text from Chris Pagliuca. He couldn't join us today, so apologize for that. Shout out to Chris Pagliuca. Thanks for putting this up, and we'll move on to the next fight. I believe this one was one of the best KOs of the year. Josh Sammon versus Eddie Gordon. Man, he earned his post fight bonus. Eddie Gordon, I'll say this, starting off in that fight, looking decent throughout a lot of that fight. He was keeping Josh in fear of his KO power standing. And he was ragdolling him to the ground to get those takedowns. But, you know, Eddie left his head wide open to that kick, and he paid for it in the worst possible way. Eddie was already, you know, leaving himself wide open to those attacks from Josh earlier in the fight. I felt like he didn't have his right hand up too much. And, you know, he was trying to set up overhands because of it. And also not being active on the ground proved lethal in this case. I mean, he was able to take Salmon down, but Josh was doing very well at being able to keep him on the ground, keep him, you know, to avoid damage. He was doing very well defensively on the ground. Josh is now 2-0 in the UFC with finishes. Not bad, you know, definitely. He's really thus far looking all right. Hopefully he can utilize that momentum, start making quicker turnarounds, and can start getting some traction going in this division. So next we'll have for Josh Sammon, I would personally like to see him fight Tom Watson. Tom is coming off a much-needed decision win in his last fight against Sam Alvey, but probably needs to pick up a little more traction. So a win over a bonus winner can do well for him. For Josh, getting a win over a tough winner is big in itself. But beating a name like Tom Watson can also get you noticed pretty well. Style-wise, this fight could be great. Both men have KO power and definitely an interesting middleweight fight. Who to speak on the performance, and who would you like to see Josh fight next?
Although I don't like Josh Sammon, I was very impressed with his performance. Eddie Gordon was looking good, but, you know, like everyone's talking about, he just kept his hands too low and paid the ultimate price for it. Beautiful switch kick and was able to hit him before he hit the ground. Awesome knockout, so can't complain about that. As far as who I'd like to see him fight next, I think, you know, there's a lot of people that want to see this, and I have to agree because it's very interesting, both of them being on the same CZ Ultimate Fighter, a little bit of animosity towards each other. Him versus Uriah Hall, I think it'd be a good fight.
Yeah, it wouldn't be a bad fight. I think Uriah Hall is a little bit up more on the food chain than Sammon is right now, but that could be a good fight for sure. You never know. Who does Uriah Hall fighting next? I know he's fighting somebody next.
I'd have to look into that one second. I can get back to you with an answer on that.
Yeah, Uriah Hall, I believe they fought No. Josh Sammon lost to the eventual winner, Kelvin Gastelum, that's right.
After talking some shit.
Yeah, you definitely came off a little cocky. I know that's kind of one of your reasons why you're not too much a fan of him. But good win for Sammon.
He's fighting Costa Philippou.
Costa, at 182, I believe.
I believe so. So if he loses, then yes, him versus Uriah Hall. If he wins, though, then he should get Uriah Hall.
Mm-hmm. I would go also with maybe – well, no, not really. Let's go with Tom. I'll stick with my pick on Tom Watson. I think that's a good fight. I think somebody gets knocked out in that fight or submitted. Who knows with Salmon's skill. He's very well-rounded if you go by his record. So definitely – definitely the best knockout on the card. Debatable, but man, you can see why he got that fight bonus. We'll move on to the main event of the prelims, so to speak. Now, Uriah Faber versus Francisco Vera. Let's just be honest. That win shouldn't have been a win. Faber clearly poked the eye and got a finish soon after because of that. But that is more on the referee, Mario Yamasaki, than on Faber. And it sucks for Rivera because I don't know about anybody else, but that fight was actually getting interesting. Debatably, Rivera had won that first round. He was fighting off the takedowns really well, and he looked like the better man on the feet in the first round. So it's unfortunate, to say the least. It should have been a no contest, in my opinion, just by looking back at the footage and seeing that. Not a win. So I was bummed out. I'm a fan of Faber too. I'm not trying to take anything away from Faber. He's still one of the best in the game for sure. But it shouldn't have been a win. I don't think. I think that, you know, if we have these cameras, if we have these angles, and you can see it right there before a decision is made on the fight, you should be able to say, okay, let's make this decision, because obviously that's what happened, and it's not a win. As far as what's next, I think there should just be a rematch. It's only right. I mean, Rivera was looking excellent in that fight. And like I said, while I'm a fan of the California kid, I want to see how the rest of that fight would have played out, barring any cage incidents. You know, if Rivera has to walk away from that fight with a loss, it only seems like the right way to set things straight. Though we do know that Francisco Rivera is looking to overturn that decision. But those very rarely get overturned, you know, so we'll see what happens. Chris, your thoughts and next fight.
I had Francisco winning the first round, which made it very interesting, because usually Uriah Faber clean sweeps these non-title fights. I don't think Faber obviously intentionally was like, oh shit, I poked him in the eyes and the referee didn't call anything, I'm going to keep going, or anything like that, but... It does tarnish this win a little bit, especially since, you know, it was looking really interesting to see, you know, Rivera do really well. I'd like to see a rematch. Faber's not knocking on the door of a title shot, and with this loss on the record of Rivera, I don't see him really moving down, and his performance is looking good, so I don't see why there shouldn't be a rematch. So I'd say go ahead and book it.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it wasn't like Faber looked like he was slowing down. He was definitely he still looked as fast and as spry as he generally is. It's not a knock on Faber skill wise. He looked just as good as ever. It's just that Francisco Rivera looked like he came there ready. You know what I mean? So definitely hope that the rematch happens, or that Rivera doesn't get treated like that was an actual loss, because I don't feel like it was. We'll move on to the UFC 181 pay per view main card. Oh, awesome main card, one of the best of the year. Tony Ferguson versus Abel Trujillo. Now, that fight was just as great as I thought it could be, for sure. It definitely came down to what we figured when we had first discussed this fight on the podcast prior, cardio. Abel did not have enough to hang in this fight. Tony weathered the early storm, a very violent storm, and was able to secure the second round victory with a submission, showing that no matter where Tony is in a fight, he is dangerous. He took advantage of Abel's tiring and was able to push the pace further than he could go. It was smart and vicious performance, and Tony Ferguson now moves to 7-1 in the UFC, which is a very strong record. And a win over Abel Trujillo and Danny Castillo in his last couple of fights should prove that he's ready to move on from the middle-level fighters, the mid-tier fighters, and start taking on the big guns, I think. So, for me, next fight, I would like to see him fight 15th-ranked Hustam Khabilov. He himself has stated that he's ready to start taking on the elite and ranked of his division and start making a title run. And very few up-and-comer, coming lightweights have that kind of record. He does, so I say he's earned it. Hustam Khabilov is recovering from an injury, but we'll soon look to come back, and a matchup between those two should be interesting. Especially since we already get to see, or since we would get to see if Tony's grappling defense has improved any by then. Chris, your thoughts and who you would like to see Tony fight next?
Tony Ferguson really impressed me with his ability to weather the storm. Abel Trujillo really gassed himself out trying to get Tony out of there fast. Tony has looked amazing so far. His last two being really impressive. As far as who he should fight, Rustam Khabilov would be an awesome fight, barring any injury, as a number two pick. Maybe Jorge Masvidal would be good too.
Jorge Masvidal, oh yeah, that would be a good one. I believe he has a fight coming up next against Norman Park. Oh wait, no, actually,
yeah, he's injured out of it.
Yeah, he got injured out of that one, and Gleison Tibau replaced him. But if Jorge can get healthy, just like Khabilov, if one of those two guys can get healthy, yeah, a matchup with Tony Ferguson makes sense. Actually, fight fans, we're going to go ahead and add my co-host, Chris Pagliuca. He can finally join us right now. 1 second. There he is. Chris Pagliuca, can you hear me?
Hey, guys. What's going on? I'm sorry, I'm late.
No worries, dude. All we've done thus far is gone through the
– Where are we at?
All we've done thus far is we've gone through the prelims, and we've just started talking about the Tony Ferguson fight, and what fight should be next for the winners of the main of the pay per view. What did you think about Tony Ferguson's fight, and who do you think he should fight next?
I think he looked good. I mean, coming out in the beginning, Abel did what he usually does. He just tried to be the aggressor, go out hard, and he had some success. Not too much. The first round was pretty close. And then Tony just came out in the second round. Abel looked tired and got his back, finished the fight, and he got him with the submission, and he looked really good doing it. So I wasn't too surprised by that. Abel looked really gassed coming into that second round.
Yeah, definitely.
As for who Tony should fight next, I think he should get a ranked opponent. I think he's deserving of one. And just looking at the rankings, I don't know. There's a few guys up there. I know Jorge Masvidal just pulled out with a fight, and I know, isn't Gleison Tibau fighting soon?
Gleison Tibau actually replaced Jorge Masvidal in that fight with Norman Park.
Yeah, maybe someone like that, the winner of that fight, or he could get maybe Michael Johnson when he comes back.
Yeah, I mean, the way I feel about it, yeah, is that he should finally get a ranked guy. He's beaten Danny Castillo and Abel Trujillo. Those are mid-level fighters, and the fact that he's beating these guys, he's knocking them off. He's 7-1 now. I think he's earned a chance at a ranked opponent at this point. So and he asked for it at the press conference following the card. So I think he's well deserving of it at this point. There's very few lightweights that is as hot as he is right now. So I personally can't wait to see it. We'll move on to the next card. Todd Duffy versus Anthony Hamilton. And what a comeback. Todd pulled a vintage Duffy in getting a quick finish. Less than a minute. It's really hard to say anything else other than that. So, I mean, hopefully this time around we will see Todd make a quicker turnaround than the norm. He has stated he's healthy and that this time that his time's now for him to make a run through the heavyweight division and with as shallow as the division is. Todd could possibly be the next big thing at heavyweight if he can continue on this kind of success en route to contendership, definitely. So for as far as who's next, I mean, if people don't agree with me, maybe a fight with like Soa Pallely or Jared Rochalt makes sense. But I would personally like to see him fight a ranked guy, see where he's at, because he is 3-1 in the UFC. So I would like to see him fight maybe like Ben Rothwell. He's 3-1, as I said. He's as dangerous as ever. So I just say give him the fast track here, see how he does. I mean, he's demolished everybody else that he's ever faced with the exception of Russo. And that was about 4 years ago when he was 24 years old. Since then, he's stayed in shape, has all finishes. So, I mean, let's see how he does against the bigger guns like Rothwell. And if you don't agree with me, like I said, maybe Pallely or Rochal makes sense. But for me, I want to see Ben Rothwell most of all. I feel that Todd could test Rothwell's standing. And Rothwell could give Todd a tougher fight than anybody else has yet. Mr. Katana, what did you think of the fight? Who should he fight next?
I'm disappointed that my pick didn't win. I'm very impressed with Todd Duffy, a.k.a. Jaws. He was able to pull out the awesome finish very early. I don't see no reason why he should get a top 15, and a few names bounce off the top of my head. I mean, I think Brad Rothwell's a little too high for him. Not saying that wouldn't be a good fight, but... Matt Mitrione, winner or loser. I'd actually like the winner of Mitrione versus Gonzaga. Actually, that works perfectly fine with me. Winner of Mitrione versus Gonzaga.
Yeah, that's a good one, too. I didn't think about that one. That's cool. Chris, what did you think of his performance, and who should Duffy fight next?
I mean, there's not really much to say about his performance. I figured
that
first round knockout, 30 seconds, comes out there, hits him with the straight right, finishes the fight, and that's just typical Todd Duffy fashion, a great comeback. And Mr. Katana kind of stole my answer there on who I think he should fight next. I think definitely the winner of Gabriel Gonzaga versus Matt Mitrione is coming up, because they're on the lower tier of the ranked heavyweights. They're fighting soon on the upcoming UFC on Fox card, so that could be a test for Duffy, and it'll really show where he's at.
Another good one, that I just thought of, since they're both really low ranked in the top 15 at number 12 and number 15, the winner of maybe Stefan Struve and Alistair Overeem.
Duffy fought Overeem before. I don't think.
Oh, that's true, huh? Well, I mean, say Struve wins. How about that?
If Struve wins, they could do that. That would be a good one.
Mm-hmm. Plus, I wouldn't even mind seeing Duffy rematch Alistair. I think he'd fare a little better this time around.
I think so too. I mean, with Reem kind of, I mean,
he falling off the way that he has, you know what I mean?
Yeah, we'll see.
You see, yeah, you never know what could happen. Any of those fights make sense. Like I said, heavyweight is very shallow. Would love to see him take a top ranked guy. Well, not top ranked, but a ranked guy. You get my gist. We'll move on to the next heavyweight fight on this card. Travis Brown versus Brendan Schaub. Now, Brown looked like how everyone kind of figured Brown should look in this fight. I mean, he fought off the takedowns well, landed hard shots standing. Though, he did finish it on the ground in dominant position, somewhere where many didn't think that Brown would be too successful. But he looked outstanding there. I mean, he was able to fight off all of Schaub's transition defenses. He was able to always work his way back to the mount. He was being patient with his shots. He wasn't just blowing his wad on trying to hit him in the head. He was picking him really well. So, I mean, Brown, for me, still needs a better win than against an unranked Schaub. But it's a great win nonetheless. So I think with that win, it's time to get him back on track because he's a top-ranked guy for a reason. He's one of the best in the world. I would personally like to see him next fight the loser of Stipe Miocic and Junior Dos Santos, which is going down this Saturday. So again, against the loser of Miocic Dos Santos, I mean, he could possibly be looking at getting himself right back into contendership, which is kind of what the UFC would need right now. Anybody, somebody to face next, the winner of Verdum and Cain. Chris, what did you think of the performance, and who would you like to see Brown fight next?
No, Travis Brown did look good. I mean, Sean got a few takedowns, which I figured he'd be able to do. And I just don't like those stoppages. It is a justified stoppage because Sean was he was trying to defend, but he wasn't really scrambling at that point. It's that kind of stoppage that it's hard from when you have a guy that size in your back and you are intelligently defending when you have your hands up, but it's hard to scramble from that position. I felt for Shaw, but yeah, Travis Brown looked good. He landed that big uppercut that set everything up to finish the fight. And next for him, there's a few good fights out there. I mean, Mark Hunt, I'm pretty sure he doesn't have a fight lined up. You can put him in there with Hunt. You can put him in there with maybe Andre Arlovsky. I don't think he has a fight set up either. I wouldn't put him against a loser of a fight. I mean, Hunt did lose, but that was for a title. I mean, you could put him against a loser of Dos Santos, Miocic too, but you could give him a Mark Hunt or Arlovsky as well.
Not bad picks. I mean, as far as the finish, he landed like 10. Like, as far as him blocking him, yeah, he blocked him, but they were unanswered. He wasn't moving, you know what I mean? So it's kind of figured to the ref that he's.
Yeah. I mean, he was. It's just hard to intelligently. He is intelligently defending. It's not like he wasn't moving and he went stiff or anything. It's more just. It's hard to scramble from that position when a guy's on your back and he weighs 250 pounds. So it sucks a little bit, especially. It sucks more just because it was 10 seconds left in the round. I would have liked to see that fight play on a little bit more, but it was a fair stoppage. Travis Brown got the win.
Yeah, I mean, but just one thing for intelligent defense is that you have to be able to move. You have to be able to get out of danger. That's kind of in the definition of intelligently defending yourself, which is trying to get out of danger, and Schaub was no longer doing that. He was just kind of taking the punches at that point. So as good stoppage, as we both agree. But yeah, I mean, Schaub wasn't going anywhere. And it sucks that refs admit to this, but they don't ever take the clock into account of whether or not they think that there should be a stoppage or shouldn't be, you know what I mean? Which is more so for the safety of fighters, so it makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, that sometimes they really shouldn't be taking the clock into consideration, but when the guys, especially if a guy was in that position and there was 5 seconds left, that would be a kind of, it just sucks for fans sometimes, but yeah, I wouldn't take the clock into consideration too much as a ref because they're not supposed to. That's not what they're not worried about the clock. They're worried about the fighter's safety, and he took that into account and made the right call.
Definitely. Mr. Katana, what did you think of Hoppe, and who would you like to see him fight next?
Went as expected, about 2 minutes longer than expected. Brendan Schaub, or shout out to Jonas Peterman, Brendan Scrub, as we like to call him. He did impress me with the beautiful takedown he got from Travis Brown. That was really impressive, actually, to me. But it went about as expected. Travis seemed to really slow down on the finish, pick his shots, which is a little uncharacteristic. But as far as who I'd like to see him fight next,
being ranked number three, it's kind of hard. I mean, there's only the champion Kane and the interim champion Fabricio Verdum, who completely dominated him. Jair Dos Santos being ranked number two. I mean, I could see him fighting JDS if JDS wins, or Stipe if Stipe wins, because, you know, they especially if JDS wins, because he needs longer than just one fight back to a title shot. He needs a few fights. So I could see that happening. But also, I'd like to see him fight maybe Hunt or Arlovski. Those would be some pretty good fights, too.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the window is so wide open for any heavyweight, because the heavyweights just, you know, there aren't too many of them around. So the list is pretty small, and not many of them are booked right now. So leaves the window wide open for these guys. Yeah, excellent. Travis Brown looked great. Looked like he should have. Went in there, looked definitely a lot crisper with his hands. And who knows if that's because of his new coach. As I said in the last podcast, I knew that he would need to leave it up to his discretion of how he utilizes the new skill set that he is learning over at Team Edmonds. I forget the name of this camp, but I'm glad to see that he's not allowing, you know, the new coaching, the new skill set that he's learning to really devolve his style, because sometimes that happens. So I'm glad that that hasn't happened. We'll Hopper Brown, can't wait to see him fight next in the next upcoming card. Next, we'll move on to Anthony Showtime Pettis versus Gilbert Melendez. I mean, wow. I mean, I saw the win coming, and man, did Anthony Pettis deliver. I mean, let's give Gilbert Melendez his credit. He did have a great game plan going, and it was working to a degree, but he was leaving himself wide open to a degree to the fast-acting counter-striking of Pettis. He got rocked and got put away, and what's even scarier is, man, Pettis looks so much more evolved as of late. Such slick, dangerous striking along with a now nearly equally dangerous submission game. Oh, Jesus. What a dangerous champion that is. As far as what's next, we kind of can figure that. As far as who's next, the Russian, Khabib Nurmagomedov, he was actually present at the post-fight press conference and made his presence known there. And he will be the next challenger for the title. And, man, that should be one hell of a title matchup. An undefeated 22-0 Khabib Nurmagomedov taking on the champion, who's 18-2, not been finished, has looked great as of late. Khabib's looked unstoppable as well, and, you know, Pettis has shown he's gotten much better. So, I mean, I can't really speak on anything other than that. I mean, because if we start talking about that matchup, we'll never get through this. So, I all I can say is I can't wait. Chris, what did you think of the matchup, and what do you think, your two cents on this next matchup with Khabib?
Yeah, it was a good fight. Gil had a good strategy. Like I said, he should. He put him against the cage, like Ben Henderson did in the first fight, except he was a bit more successful with it. Landed some good body shots. I mean, those body shots definitely hurt, but Pettis did do a good job landing counter strikes back. He tried, and it's hard. He can't land those kicks when Gil's in that tight. So he had a few kicks he threw, but he wasn't really able to get them off as he would like to. And then his takedown defense did look pretty good, too. He was able to stuff a few of Gil's takedown attempts. He did get taken down a few times, but he was able to pop right back up, and then that submission was slick. Like, he just pulled it right off, and Gil didn't see it coming. This is a guy who's never been finished before, especially submitted. This guy trains with the Diaz brothers, and he's used to that. He's used to getting put in those positions, but Pettis was just slick with it, got it. Gil rolled over, and Pettis just had it. Like, right away, when I saw Pettis lock that up, I knew the fight was over. I knew Gil wasn't getting out of there when Pettis locked that in, because it was tight.
Yeah, especially when you're able to mount a guy like that in the guillotine. I was like, oh, no.
Yeah, it was tight. And about the Khabib fight coming up next, that's a tough fight for Pettis. That's not a good style matchup for him. He's going to have to try to find a way to get Khabib, like, just away from him and be able to unload with a few kicks or something. Because Khabib is, in my opinion, a much better wrestler than Gilbert Melendez. Probably the best in the division. This guy, I don't know, if Pettis can't stop that takedown, he's going to be in some trouble here. He's going to have to look to work off his back a lot, look for submissions, and he's going to be spending a lot of time on his back against Khabib.
Definitely, I agree. I mean, imagine once he's put against the cage by Khabib, it's definitely going to be a different story than what Gilbert had going. So
for sure, and Khabib's not coming back until sometime around May or April, he said he was cleared. So that's going to – I don't know how long Pettis wants to take off, because that's a good 6 months. And if Pettis doesn't want to take that long off, if Dos Anjos winds up winning that fight against Nate Diaz, he might go in there with him. And if he loses, he might wind up going in there with Cerrone Jury, well, the winner of that. If it depends how long he plans on taking off. But
yeah, well, what was announced today, Chris, was actually Anthony Pettis walk away from that fight with a broken hand. And he's suspended. He's thus far suspended up to 6 months, but that's just the maximum requirement. Like, that's the maximum that they'll put on a suspension for a broken hand, because they figure that that's the worst a broken hand can get in the cage is for that kind of injury is 6 months. It could just be a small one in which he'd be out for maybe 2 months. So it's dependent on how severe the injury is, because he could be back in the gym in like 2.5 months probably. So. Well,
yeah, I didn't hear about him breaking.
Yeah, it was announced today, like a couple hours ago, actually. So
yeah, I must have just missed it. I've been at the gym, which is also why I was late to the podcast today. But
how dare you? No, I'm just kidding.
No, Khabib definitely deserves a shot next. No one deserves as much as he does in the lightweight division right now. And if they can give him that shot, especially if Pettis is going to be out for a few months, see, that sounds like perfect timing, and they should just give Khabib the shot. He deserves it.
Definitely, Mr. Katana. Your thoughts on this fight, and who, and what do you think of the matchup, Pettis and Magomedov?
Again, I'm really disappointed. Melendez lost.
So she get.
Melendez employed an awesome game plan, and what's really impressive, and what I mentioned, which I didn't picture it happening this way, is Melendez needed to watch out for Pettis' very explosive submission game. And when I was saying that, I thought, like, you know, he got him down, he needs to watch out for the explosive submissions off the back. So this goes to show that Pettis can have the tiniest of windows, but if he has it, he will take your neck home with him and just choke you out.
Well, I told you about that, you goofy bastard. What the hell?
I must have forgotten about it.
I mentioned it. Did I not mention this, Mr. Pagliuca, about the submission game? I believe that was my pick, a third-round submission. I was off by a round, but...
Well, no, I meant, like, I was thinking more so off his back, not like a submission.
Oh. Well, I think that was Pettis' first guillotine submission of his career. Most of it, yeah, I mean, all of his submissions, three triangles and an armbar... or two arm bars have off his back, so that was the first guillotine submission that he's had. So I guess I know what you mean there. But
yeah,
man,
Pettis is becoming more well-rounded fight by fight. It's really impressive.
Yeah, it's scary, man. I mean, if that guy can just stay healthy, for the love of God, if he can stay healthy, he could really be one of the best fighters in that division's history ever. Possibly, he could really get to that point. He's just got to stay more active. So hopefully that's what we see from him. Anthony Pettis, Khabib Nurmagomedov. I'm looking forward to it. One of the many things to look forward to in 2015. I can't wait. I'm sure you guys can either. We'll move on to the main event. Controversy erupts, of course. What the sport wouldn't be without it. Robbie Lawler versus Johnny Hendricks. All right, first off, I am happy for Lawler, Robbie Lawler. I'm a big Robbie Lawler fan. I'm a big Hendricks fan, too. So, and I said in the last podcast, I wanted him to win, and he did. But for anyone thinking that it was a screw job, like it was just so one-sided on Hendricks' part, you really need to go back and rewatch that fight and sit down calmly and just see how close it was. The way I scored it, Robbie, with the first round, I gave him, since he did more damage, he came out strong. And ultimately, you know, just barely got it. I mean, Hendricks ended the round strong, but I believe Lawler did more. Rewatching it, I believe Lawler did more in that first round, so I gave it to him. The second, I gave it to Hendricks. He was clearly outstriking him in that round. Round three, the first half of it was kind of more of the same, but then Hendricks in the second half of it started utilizing his wrestling throughout the second half of that round. So, and the fourth. Closest round of the fight, I believe. I scored it for Hendricks initially just based on ground control. I didn't think that Robbie was doing too much damage off of his back, but rewatching it, it's a lot. It looked like he was doing more damage than I had previously thought. So, but I still gave Hendricks the fourth round, but I can see the argument where Robbie does get that fourth round, which in this fifth round scoring makes the biggest deal, because the fifth round clearly goes to Robbie. There wasn't much being done in the fifth round by either man until that last minute where Robbie just blitzed him and tried looking for the finish. And so, man, this fight was super freaking close. So no matter how or no matter what you say, what you feel, I mean, the trilogy fight needs to happen. It's obvious what is next. No matter what, it'll be a trilogy fight or Robbie Lawler or Rory McDonald. So, while Hendricks recovers maybe or attempts to earn a rematch, I don't know what'll happen. I personally want the trilogy fight more. I wanted it even before this fight would happen. So, but I wouldn't want to be the guy that screws a guy like Rory McDonald out of a title fight if he already earned it. So no matter what happens, I won't complain. But man, it's just that I mean, two really good fights for both men this year, and it would just be a travesty if that trilogy fight never happened for sure. Mr. Katana, what did you think of this insane fight, and what do you think should happen moving forward, the trilogy or Rory McDonald?
Watching it live, I thought Hendricks, definitely no one won 4 rounds to 1. Let's get that out of the way right now.
Oh, yeah. No, that judge was out of his damn mind. Sure. Get the hell out of here. No way in hell Robbie won it 4-1.
That was ridiculous. When I heard 49-46, I was like, oh, I guess Hendricks won.
Get the fuck out of here.
I had Hendricks, in my opinion, while watching it, live, 3-2. But then I rewatched it, absolutely no sound, just myself. And then I had it's really tricky. I mean, I have 1-5 Lawler clearly, 2 Hendricks barely, but still I give him a nod.
In round two?
Yeah, in round two.
I think that was Hendricks' most dominant round. I mean, he was piecing that dude up on the stand up.
I thought 3 was Hendricks' most dominant round. Really? I gave round 3 to Hendricks. Round four, it's very tricky to score. It depends on what you're looking for. I mean, Hendricks landed slightly more and got the takedown. Didn't really do anything with it, but got the takedown and had him down long enough for, obviously for a takedown to count. It wasn't just he got him on his butt and he popped back up real quick. But Lawler landed the more memorable shots, the more significant shots. Definitely nothing Hendricks is in a lot of trouble, but more significant shots. And he ended the round really strong because Hendricks was holding on to a single, doing absolutely nothing with it, but holding on. And Lawler elbowed him for, a good 10, 12 seconds and ended that round really strong. That round, it depends on what you're looking for. And I could totally see that round being a draw, but I could see the argument for both men. I'd actually probably score it myself a draw now watching it twice, but watching it the first time, Hendricks. As far as what to do next, I don't know, because I am really interested in this trilogy fight. But you kind of don't want to screw up Roy McDonald out of this fight. But I'm personally more interested in the trilogy fight.
Hey, guys, sorry to go off track for a second, just to go back to Khabib Nurmagomedov. He just posted on Facebook of the article of Pettis being out possibly 6 months. He said, come on now, is this guy made of glass?
I mean, unless the guy's in the cage, he's not very healthy a lot of the time, so.
Yeah, no. That's definitely true. I just thought that was funny. But on the Hendricks Lawler fight, I agree exactly with both of you guys. When I watched it, I scored it for Johnny Hendricks. And when I heard the scorecards, I thought Johnny, when they said 49-46, I was like, all right, I guess they gave it to Hendricks because he was going for the takedown so much. I was really surprised that anyone got a 4-1, to be honest, but I thought Hendricks won the fight at that point. Then I went back and rewatched it. And it was just ridiculously close. Like, I scored the first round slightly for Robbie Lawler. That was a really close round. But he came out very strong. And then Hendricks just got him against the fence, went for takedowns that got stuffed. And Lawler was working on the clinch in that round. And towards the end, Hendricks did get a takedown, which made it really close. But aside from that, he didn't really do anything in the round. So I gave that to Lawler. Round two was a pretty good round for Hendricks. He won the round pretty clearly. Round three, Lawler didn't do much and kind of fell asleep in that round, and it was odd. He would move forward, reach his hand out, and just wouldn't throw it. Joe Rogan thought he hurt his hand, but I'm not sure what happened in that. He just kind of didn't do much, and Hendricks won that round and was opening up with leg kicks, throwing a lot of strikes, and he got a few. I think he got a takedown that round, if not two. And then from there, round four was where this is where it came down to. Round four was where the fight just. This is what it called the fight. In the fourth round, Hendricks was winning most of the rounds slightly, very slightly. It wasn't much going on in that round until the last like minute of the round. He was on a single. Robbie just unloaded on him, and that's where the controversy comes in. I could see where you can give it to either guy in that round, or you could score it a 10-10 round and call it a draw from there, because the fifth round was clearly a Robbie Lawler round. All Hendricks really did was just dive in on that single, and Robbie just unloaded on him big time in the fifth, and then he got up and just went at him and tried to finish the fight. So I scored it. The first round was for Lawler, fifth round was for Lawler, third and second were for Hendricks, and that fourth round was so close, I really didn't know how to score it. I could see it being for either guy. I have no problem with a 48-47 either way, but it could be a draw. A lot of guys are too hesitant to call that round a draw in just like the judge from the judge's standpoint, but you could call that round the draw, or you could call that fight a draw, and that one judge who scored it 4-1 is out of his mind.
Definitely. I mean,
I think it was Glenn Trowbridge, so I'll call him out.
I thought it was Cecil Peoples. Man, it was just such a tough fight. The call is closer than it looked, definitely. Because it's funny, because when the decision came, it felt almost obvious that Hendricks had won. And then you watch it and you see how close it actually was. It was really weird.
Yeah, I agree. I thought I even tweeted out the new GSP won. It looks like the new GSP won. Because he basically, the judges did take into effect, and I think this is a good thing. I think Hendricks went 5-for-17 on takedowns. Lawler stuffed a lot of takedowns, and when Hendricks got the takedowns, he didn't really do too much with them. Yeah. And a lot of times Lawler popped right back up, so yeah, I think that's good that was taken into account a little bit, that Hendricks didn't get the win just for getting, like, keep going for takedowns and doing nothing but that. He did, in rounds 2 and 3, he did land some strikes, but aside from that, he really was just going for that takedown. The fifth round, I think he thought he had it secured and just said, oh, well, I'm just going to take the fight down and win it again like he did in the first one.
Yeah, bad thoughts. I want the trilogy so bad. Fight fans.
I want to see Rory versus Robbie. Rory deserves his shot. Hendricks is 1-2 in the last fight. And I know he's lost 2 title fights. The fight with GSP was close. The Lawler fight was close, but You gotta give it a Rory. He deserves a shot more than anyone else. And if Hendricks won fight, if he wins that fight, he has to do what Lawler did.
I want what I want. So shush. All right.
See if Rory puts out a lot of leg kicks against Robbie Lawler, because that was
I wouldn't be surprised by that, especially if he puts out the jab too.
Jab and leg kicks. I mean, he never really seemed to check him, which was very alarming to me. And Hendricks put on a lot of leg kicks, and this is a guy not known for leg kicks at all, so yeah. You should see what happens with that.
I think in their first fight, and let's remember, Rory and Robbie went to a split decision in their first fight. Robbie definitely won that fight, but Rory didn't look like himself in that fight. He looked a little off. I would like to see how he would do in a second fight. I think he has a good shot in that fight. And a 5-rounder at that. I don't believe the first one was a 5-rounder, so a 5-rounder could make it look really interesting. I'd like to see you come out in that one.
This is madness. All right, anyway, this is a good thing we don't get to make the decision, because, man, it's such a tough one to make. Again, I don't want to take an opportunity away from Rory McDonald. Either fight makes sense. But, fight fans, sound off who you would like to see win in the comment section below. I personally want the trilogy. If Rory gets it, it's all power to him, and that should be a great fight, a great rematch anyways, either way. We'll move on from that. Man, again, overall, what was your thoughts on the card? Mr. Katana, you first.
Overall, I thought the card was awesome. It really delivered. I mean, on paper, it looked great. Watching it, actually getting to experience it live, it was very awesome. All fights delivered.
Definitely. Chris?
Yeah, it was a really good card. It lived up to the hype. I mean, there was a lot of finishes on this card. We saw a lot of submissions, knockouts. We saw a good mix of everything. Some good fights that went to decision too, like the Sergio Pettis fight. That was a good fight, and it won fight of the night for a good reason. There was a lot of back and forth in some of these fights. I actually thought that the only fight that disappointed me a little bit on the main card was the Hendricks Lawler fight. I didn't think it was that great until the end of it. It was a little boring.
Oh, how dare you.
I mean, it was. I think more the excitement came about how close it was, it was a close fight, but it wasn't the most exciting fight. The first fight was definitely a lot more exciting.
I can definitely agree with that.
I agree with that. The first one was more exciting. I was excited watching this one, though.
I mean, but that's just me. It was exciting. It had its good points, but then there was, like, just towards that, like, second and third round where Waller kind of didn't engage as much, it kind of got a little boring there.
Yeah. Overall, great card, great fights. One of the best cards of the year, I feel.
Definitely.
Yeah, we'll definitely get into that when we start talking about event of the year. I think that's a candidate at this point. So great fights all around. Especially, it had its very awkward moment mid-pay-per-view, and we'll get into this finally. The signing of Phil Brooks, a.k.a. CM Punk, the former WWE superstar. From what I know about CM Punk, I've watched the WWE before. I don't anymore. But back then, when I was watching it, he was a big star. Became even bigger when I stopped watching it. So, from what I understand, he is now going to be joining the UFC's roster at possibly middleweight. Henner Gracie will be his main coach. Henner Gracie plays coach to many fighters, including Ronda Rousey. As far as being in her corner, for like Ronda Rousey, he's been in there as well as for GSP at one point. He's a great asset. I'm sorry.
He works with Lyoto Machida, Brendan Schaub, guys like that. He's been works with a lot of UFC guys.
Yeah, definitely a great coach to have in your corner. So CM Punk now signed. He will start off at 0-0. For people that don't know, CM Punk has been doing jiu-jitsu and Muay Thai since his teenage years. He's well enough experienced to at least compete in MMA. To compete in the UFC, I don't know. He will most likely compete at middleweight, though welterweight has been rumored. He's not ruling it out, according to him, his words. But he's yet to announce where his main camp will be. But according to the UFC, they plan on giving him a guy that doesn't even have a Wikipedia page, essentially. He's going to be 1-0, 2-0, or 2-1, they said. So that fight will be more for spectacle than anything, just so everybody knows that. It's not like, they picked him up for anything other than that. It'll be interesting to see where CM Punk can fit in the MMA world. It's good and bad for the UFC, I think. I think CM Punk will bring more viewers over to the UFC, specifically young kids, because I know that was his main fan base, I believe, which is good for the UFC, and it's bad in the sense that it kind of shows that the UFC is getting okay with signing over these guys. It's kind of got like a pride feel to it, where they're just signing some one-off show to show you, and it's just something to watch, Like for me, it just sucks that guys like Ben Askren or John Wayne Parr aren't allowed in the UFC, but a pro wrestler like Phil Brooks can get in with no experience whatsoever. You know what I mean? As far as my thoughts, I think it's a good thing and a bad thing. We'll see how he can do. I will watch. I mean, why not? I mean, it'll be interesting to see how he does. Not from a ranking standpoint, not from a a competitive standpoint. I just want to see how he does. Because it'll be interesting. I mean, he has the balls to walk away from the comfy living that the WWE I would assume gives him when it comes to money, as well as I'm sure he gets hurt doing that. It's very rough.
Well, he did get fired. I'll give him that. He is a tough guy for going out there and doing it, but he got fired.
Oh, did he get fired? I wasn't aware of that. Yeah. Okay. I don't know too much. As far as from what I feel, CM Punk, he has the balls to get in there. He's gonna get in there. He's gonna fight. So no matter what, I'll have respect for that, and so we'll see how he does. I mean, I can't knock him for wanting to try and chase another career in this, especially so early on. It's never easy to do it like this. There are a few fighters in the UFC that started at 0-0, like Amir Sadal and Matt Mitrione, and they've shown it can be done. So you can't count out Phil Brooks, as that's his real name. So you can't count him out. I won't, and I'll be a little intrigued to see how he does. Mr. Katana, I'll get your first thoughts on this.
At first I was a little hesitant, but I'm actually more and more behind the idea of it as far as being really, really interested in it. I'm not necessarily a big fan of CM Punk, the wrestler, but I'm a big fan of, him as a person. He seems like a really nice guy.
I'm a huge comic book fan, and so is he as well. He's actually going to be writing the Thor annual, I believe.
Oh, I heard about that. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that'd be pretty awesome. I mean, he's basically living one of those lives I want to live, you know? Like,
yeah, being a nerd and kicking ass. Why, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I mean, the pair of balls on this guy, not have a professional MMA fight, but to go out there on the world, not that he's not obviously comfortable with being in front of a lot of people and whatnot, but to go right into the UFC, I mean, I can't even. But I cannot wait. I'm very curious to see who they put him up against. I mean, I'm wondering if it's going to be some person off top, or if it's going to basically be, you know, someone who's fighting for sandwiches. We don't know.
But what happened? That was funny. All right. Well, then we shall see. Miss Chris, I know you have some thoughts on this. Definitely, please,
yeah,
love to hear.
There's, as everyone's been saying, there's good things and there's bad things about this. And the bad things aren't about Phil Brooks, CM Punk. They're not about him. They're more towards the UFC that they're giving a lot of people saying that they don't like that they're giving this guy a chance who's never fought. And they won't let a guy like Ben Askren in. They won't let, like, they signing him instead of signing up-and-coming guys. But the thing is this isn't for, like, his skill set. It's because they're going to draw pay-per-view money from him. They're definitely going to put this guy on a pay-per-view with good reason because he's going to draw. I would say they probably put him in the first fight on the pay-per-view, maybe the second fight. They're not going to put him anywhere in, like, the main event or co-main event, I don't think, at least, because that's not the place to put him. You put him on the pay-per-view to get more buys, but you don't put him on the top end. He does have experience. He's a brown belt in jiu-jitsu under Henry Gracie, as said before. And he does have some Muay Thai experience, and yeah, so I think if with some good training, he'll be able to fight a guy who isn't like the greatest guy. He'll probably get someone off the Ultimate Fighter, I would think. Maybe someone like, as Dana White was saying, he's going to get someone like a 1-0. I don't think they'll give him like a 1-0, 2-1 guy. Maybe they'll give him just someone off the Ultimate Fighter who only has a few wins. Say even someone like Justin Jones, who just fought Corey Anderson. He was only 3-0. Maybe someone like that. Not Justin Jones himself, but someone like that. And yeah, he's going to be fighting at middleweight or welterweight. I think he'd be better served at a welterweight because he's 6'2 and he walks around now at like 200 pounds, but he's not really the biggest guy. He's not like a big, like, he doesn't look like the most muscular guy. I think he can make 170 pretty safely if he cuts just a little bit more weight depending on where his body fat is, but I think it's just going to be fun. It's fun. It's just a fun thing. You're going to have a guy in there. People are going to be excited to see him, whether they want him to win or lose. It's a good move for the UFC because they're going to make money from it. And it's fun for the fans. It makes things a little bit more fun than that it hasn't been in a little while since, like, Brock left the sport. People went wild when Brock was fighting. And that could bring a little bit of that back where fans are really getting back into the UFC. They want to see this guy fight. They want to see what happens. They invested interest in this. And it makes the whole aroma of MMA just that more fun and edge. I'm really excited to see what happens.
The aroma. Yeah. Good word. I like that word. Aroma. All right. Let's get this out of the way, too, because it was actually a fan question. So let's just mention it. What are our thoughts on Jason David Frank, who has been calling CM Punk out for 2 years now, to an MMA fight? Now, Jason David Frank, for anybody that doesn't know, is the former Green Power Ranger of the Mighty Morphin Power Ranger season back in the 90s. He back then, if you knew about it, you knew that the guy was credentialed in martial arts, karate specifically. He's a seventh degree black belt in karate. He's been doing it all his life. He has MMA fights he has four amateur that we heard of. Is that correct, Chris? Four amateur and one professional, correct?
Yeah, I don't know about amateur, but I just saw he has one professional fight.
There's your 1-0 guy right there. I mean, it would be one wild ass fight if they signed Jason David Frank to the UFC and put him against CM Punk in the first fight. That would be some wild, just pride feeling. It would feel like we're watching a Japan card all of a sudden if we saw that. But at the same time, while many people want to see the UFC, you know, hold this kind of merit of class and, you know, and I guess kind of, what's the word? Like there's just a, there used to be a special thing in being a UFC fighter, but I don't feel like that's there anymore. And if you're already on that boat, why not? I mean, I guess mainly I wouldn't be against seeing him get signed and fighting just CM Punk. I don't think I'd want to see him fight anybody else. It would just be one of those wild off fights that you'd see. I personally wouldn't be, you know, opposed to it. He has MMA experience. He has martial arts experience. He's been doing it his whole life. So I mean, again, I wouldn't be opposed to it. Chris, or actually Mr. Katana first. I'd like to hear your thoughts on it, knowing that.
Why don't you want to hear my thoughts first?
Because I want to save the best for last. Maybe you don't know, or maybe I just want to hear what Mr. Katana says because I know he's a fan. We'll see. Yeah.
He actually just wanted to pick the best one first, so I'll go ahead and answer.
Hey, he said it, not me, all right?
I don't know how I feel about that.
All right, well, we'll talk about it.
I'm excited for this, because this is something you could totally put on, like, a Pride or a movie poster.
Yeah.
Versus the former, like, I believe CM Punk's a Grand Slam WWE Championship. Those of you not familiar, Grand Slam WWE Champion means he won every single belt in the organization. So... put that up against the Green Ranger, you got yourself like a $80 pay-per-view on buy. Not really.
This is so crazy.
One thing alarming, though, is that can JDF make the weight that CM Punk wants to fight at?
Yeah, he has fought a light heavyweight throughout most of those fights. He has fought a heavyweight as well, but that was more so because he just didn't need to cut the weight for that fight. But we will see. I mean, yeah, that's a good question to bring up. I mean, CM Punk might compete at middleweight. But then again, we still don't even know where CM Punk is weight-wise. He doesn't seem like an overall muscular kind of guy, so maybe he can't lose as much weight as he would like to believe or any of us would like to.
He said he's walking around now at 200 pounds.
Oh, wow. Okay, so yeah, 185 seems to be like the best. I wouldn't want a guy walking around at 120 to lose 30 pounds and go to welterweight. I would rather he fight at middleweight.
A lot of guys fighting at 170 walk around at around.
But they don't have, they don't, but they have like muscular ass physiques and they're all built up. Phil Brooks doesn't have that.
It depends on his body fat right now. If he's at a low body fat, 185 is probably a better place. If he can lose some fat and drop to 190, he could probably make that.
I don't think he can lose the fat. I mean, looking at him. Thinking about how
he doesn't have much fat on him, so maybe 185 is a better place. When most likely.
And if they did sign Jason David Frank and couldn't make that weight, maybe Franklin weight. I don't know, 195. Again, so I mean that's really up to the discretion of the UFC to figure out the next opponent. This is all just speculation and thinking that the Green Ranger would get signed. As we said, the reason why this is all up in the air, why it's even a thought, is because Jason David Frank has been calling CM Punk out to a fight. For 2 years. I don't know why. I don't know where the beef really stems from. I got to look into that. But we'll see what happens. It's just more speculation. Chris, your thoughts on that?
Best for last. Okay. Uh-huh. I'm going to take my time with this now. All right. All right. So just going into it, I think it's going to intrigue a lot of people if they put these two in a fight. I think this makes it even more of a spectacle. And I know the UFC does want to promote CM Punk in a way where they can sell pay-per-views, but, I mean, I don't think they're going to sign another guy who's fought once. I don't think they want to do that. I think they want to put CM Punk in against a real, like, a guy who's fought. I mean, see, Jason David Frank's fought once. I think they want to put him in against someone.
Well, he's fought five times. Like, the amateur fights were
very professionally.
Well. Yeah, that's true. I mean, but, yeah, I mean, his amateur fights.
I just don't think they're going to sign another guy like this and then try to just throw him in the mix, because if he beats CM Punk, and then, I think it would just go oddly. And also, I think they're going to put CM Punk against someone who would be a well-suited fit for him. I think they're going to put him against someone who he can actually work against. I'm not sure how good Jason David Frank is exactly, but I think they're going to give CM Punk a fight that's winnable, and if that fight's not winnable, and if Jason David Frank can't make weight at 185, I don't think they want to do that. I don't think they have much interest in him. But who knows? It's possible. Anything's possible with the UFC. I was in shock when they said they signed CM Punk.
Yeah, I mean, watching it live. Oh, my God.
I mean, yeah. That was wild. I mean, I think that was supposed to be the announcement for the time is now, but they were saying it was a Reebok deal.
Oh, yeah, huh.
Yeah, it could have been either one. I was really surprised. I mean, I get why they're doing it, but yeah, I don't think they'll make that fight.
We'll see. It's a wild topic for sure. I mean, when we learn more, if we hear from CM Punk more, we'll speak more on this matter. Other than that, CM Punk is coming to the UFC. If you don't like it, deal with it. It's happening. For some, it sucks. For some, it's a spectacle. For some, it's awesome. But no matter what, I believe that all of us will be watching to see what happens, I think. So either way, the UFC wins in that aspect. So we'll move on to some fan questions to end this out. It's been a wild podcast thus far, talking about this awesome card and this crazy announcement, the new signing, and a potential crazy matchups. You know, who knows what the future has. 2015 is going to be freaking wild, man. This is going to be so crazy. We'll move on to the fan questions that kind of have to do with next year. We'll go to the first one. Who do you see being the next superstar in MMA to retire next? This coming from Khalid Lazar Jominga. I'm sorry if I pronounced your name wrong in any way. I already suck at names, so.
CM Punk.
Okay, well, that's a fast answer, Chris. All right, Mr. Katana.
That was a joke.
Oh, okay. Well, you'll be next.
Do I see you retiring? Is that the question?
Who will be the next superstar in MMA to retire, not specifically the UFC?
I mean, fuck it, the raid's going, Anthony Pettis.
Oh, Jesus. Okay. Is that your final answer?
I'm dead serious. Like, at the
rate, I believe you. I mean, at least this injury was caused in the fight, and that's an injury that can be quick to come back from, especially when we don't even know the severity of his hand injury. But, I mean, I get the point you're trying to make. Any other possible answer?
Would you call Rich Franklin a superstar at this point?
I mean, he used to be. So, I mean, I think we should just take the word superstar out. And mainly just go with, you know, fighters that have been in the game, you know about them, kind of deal, you know?
I can totally see, I mean, like, Rich Franklin, I could probably see that happening soonish.
Yeah, I mean, he hasn't competed all year. He hasn't competed in, like, almost 2 years now, so.
Yeah.
It's been a while. Mr. Pagliuca.
I don't know. I think I could see, there's a lot of heavyweights I could see retiring soon. I'm not going to say Rich Franklin because, I mean, yeah, that's pretty obvious. He's only going to fight one more time, maybe. So he's kind of already retired. Obviously, GSP's kind of already retired. I could see a guy like Frank Mir or maybe Overeem if he loses again. Oh, someone like that. Possibly one of those guys.
As much as I hate to say it, thinking about this, I've probably got to go with Mauricio Shogun Hua. I don't like having to answer that because he's one of my favorite fighters. But I just see that his time is kind of dwindling in this sport, and I don't like it. But I see him retiring soon, and I think it'll be at the end of this next year. I think he'll go down to middleweight, or he'll stay at light heavyweight, and he might lose again. And if that happens, I think he should just call it quits there. As hard as that is for a guy like him to do, he's a savage. He's one of the best in the history of MMA. That's who I see retiring next year. And I'm about to cry. So this is a tough one. I love that fighter to death. I'm a big Pride fan back in the day. So we'll see what happens. That's a tough. I mean, hopefully everybody stays healthy. I mean, those are all good answers possibly for who might retire next year. And it just sucks because we all remember that they've all had great fights, great moments. We'll see what happens. Next question. Probably the last one. We don't want to make this too long. With which up and coming fighter in the game today? I guess that would maybe mean like a mid tier fighter or something like that. Do you see having a breakout year next year? That's a good question. Chris, I'll let you go first. Yeah, go ahead.
Yay. Good answer for this. Hopefully he can stay healthy. I have a few good answers for this, but one of my top guys for this one is Brandon Thatch. That's not a bad one. Brandon Thatch is a hell of a fighter. This guy, I have really high hopes for him. He has a great style. He just can't stay healthy. The guy's always getting hurt. If he could stay healthy, he could be a force at welterweight. I could see him beating a lot of the guys in the top 15. I'm interested in him. Who else would be interesting? Ally Quinta, he just beat Ross Pearson. And he's coming up again. He had that one loss to, I forget the guy's name
Michael
now.
Michael Chiesa?
Excuse me?
Michael Chiesa?
No, I'm not. No, the loss he had to Mitch Clark.
Oh.
He lost to Chiesa, but then he went on that streak, lost to Mitch Clark, and then he just went out there and had a pretty good job against Ross Pearson. I think he's another good up-and-comer. A guy just outside of the top 15, he has a fight with Joe Lozon coming up, and if he's able to get through Lozon, I love both of those guys. I don't know who's going to win that one. I can see Lozon winning, but if he's able to get through Lozon, there's big things to come for him.
Not bad. Mr. Katana.
To have a short list going, I can see CM Punk.
That's not bad. I mean, I personally think that if CM Punk were to have a breakout year, he's not really a middle tier fighter though. You know what I mean? That's the problem with that is that because he's not a middle tier fighter, that he definitely that I don't think that he qualifies for this for this particular question.
As far as women goes, I mean, there's a lot you can pick from it. At strawweight, obviously whoever wins this season, but if these women isn't the one of the ones that wins, I can see Randa Markos and Rose really breaking out in 2015. At bantamweight, I mean, Betche, I mean, aka the Horsewoman Killer, and Jessica Ai, and Holly Holm, who we haven't really seen anything of yet in UFC, but especially if she gets in the two or so fights going on in 2015, you can really see her breaking out. At welterweight, I mean, he has had an awesome showing in 2014, but depending on where it goes, 2015 could be a year of Gastelum.
The year of Gastelum. I wish he had a better last name, but continue. Unless that's it.
That's actually all I have to think of as far as right now. I mean, Kyoji Hiraguchi, another guy to watch out for at flyweight, so that's another one to throw down.
I would add Paige VanZant to that list. She looks like she could definitely bring some thunder to that division next year.
Who you got, Nick?
I would go for one of each division. For flyweight, he stole my answer.
Went all out. I said two people.
Shut up. Anyway, for flyweight, I got, you stole my answer, Kyoji Horiguchi. For bantamweight, I got, I think Eric Perez starts to make a better comeback in this year. He's taking some time off to train, heal some wounds, and so I think he'll come back this upcoming year strong. Featherweight. I don't have one for featherweight. We'll go to lightweight. Lightweight, I think that Tony Ferguson makes it a huge year, gets in the rankings, makes it into the top seven. Next year. For welterweight, Kelvin Gastelum, yeah, he's already had a great year, so it's kind of hard to put him there. It's to say he's mid-tier now that he's ranked, but we'll go with Kelvin. For middleweight, I would say, I mean, other than, yeah, it's hard to say for that one as well. I will say this, Yoel Romero has had one hell of a year this year and the last. He's undefeated still, and so, you know, he could definitely be looking at a possible title shot by the end of next year if he keeps up the good work. He's in his next fight against Jacare Souza, so he's got a tough agenda next year. Light heavyweight, I don't have anybody. For heavyweight, Todd Duffy, I think if he stays healthy, he's going to have one hell of a freaking year next year. So those are all mine right there. With that, guys, I think we'll go ahead and end this this one
actually,
off.
I'd like to throw in one more.
Do it!
Every year is this person's year anyway. So
I'm
going to
say Jake
Shields.
Oh, my bad. Okay, go ahead.
The submission magician, the striking god, Jake Shields. 2015 will be his year.
The striking god. He does have a number one contenders fight coming up next year for World Series of Fighting. So we'll see how he does in under the banner, and if he can get that title shot against Usmar Palhares, in which case I would be interested in seeing that fight. That sounds like an interesting fight to see between the tree trunk and the striking god. So
well, him or John Fitch, whichever one wins.
Yeah, either way, I mean, it's going to be a 2015, man. While this year has been plagued by injuries, it does set up 2015 to have a fantastic year. We have all these guys that made the most of this year going into this upcoming year. It's just, man, I'm stoked for it. And we're going to talk about that in one of the podcasts coming up. For anybody that wants to know about our next one, we will be having another one, hopefully in tomorrow, where we will be discussing this weekend's fights. Both the Ultimate Fighter 20 finale and the UFC on Fox 13 card. My co-host, Mr. Pagliuca, will be joining me. The admins, whoever will join us.
I'll be on time this time, next time.
You better. Anyway, yeah, we'll have whoever we can get to join. Fans, please keep submitting the questions and the messages of the MMA Discussion Facebook page. Got my Twitter handle, at Nick the Phantom, if you want to get a hold of me. At Chris Pagliuca for Chris's Twitter handle, as well as at Sports of Anarchy, which we are brought to you by our website, sportsanarchy.com. Please go check out the site. Please remember our sponsors, submissionfc.com, promo code sportsanarchy10, mmaprofit.com. Please, guys, remember, reminder, we are on iTunes. If you're not listening to us on iTunes yet, we're there. We're also on the Stitcher app. It's now free.
Missing out.
You are, okay? You just
MMA Discussion on iTunes.
No S at the end, just so you guys remember. Yes, no S at the end. We're available on the Stitcher app. Yeah,
guys, make sure to leave us a review on iTunes. Just give us 5 stars. Give us some feedback about the show. Don't give us bad ratings. We don't want bad ratings. We want good ratings.
Are you done? Okay. Get the Stitcher app if you don't already have it. It's free. It's downloadable for any smartphone. So if you guys have a smartphone, an iPhone, a Nokia, whatever the hell you got, get the Stitcher app. It's not just us. There are plenty of other great podcasts on there. We're the best as far as MMA is concerned. Just saying, you guys, please give us a like, a follow, a subscribe. We appreciate all the feedback we've been getting on the Facebook page because of it. Please hit us up again at the Facebook.com MMA Discussion. Get in hold with any of our admins if you'd like to get a question in on the podcast, as I've said before. Thank you guys for joining, Chris, Mr. Pagliuca, Mr. Katana. You guys are awesome as always. Hopefully we'll get on this next podcast tomorrow. Guys, thank you again. Remember all our sponsors. Remember Stitcher, iTunes, subscribe. Love you. Later.
Yeah, share the show.
What?
Share the show.
Share the show. Mr. Katana, Chris, sign off.
Later. Thank you guys for listening.
Thank you very much again for having me, guys. It was a pleasure talking, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Awesome talking to you, man. And, guys, thank you again for listening. We really appreciate all the support you've been getting. Just keep sharing it. Keep liking everything, and it will be big soon. Just keep doing what you're doing. Thank you all for listening.
Real quick. Little thing news to throw in, just saw on Facebook, Jake Shields versus Brian Foster at the main event of Wasoff 17. Mark the calendar, January 17th.
Did you say Wasoff? Wasoff.
Yeah,
Wasoff. All right, you heard it here. Wasoff. Go. All right. Thank you guys for listening. Have a good rest of the day.